Yo, yo, listener, this is the Plastic Pills podcast. You have clicked on, either on purpose or accidentally, our ADIEU LACAN super episode.
Super episode.
It's a big one.
Which you can probably tell from the length. I'm not sure. It's probably. I hope it's not 3 hours. It's somewhere around there. Anyway, we smashed 2 episodes together on ADIEU LACAN, which is something, you know, all of us have to say maybe at some point or another. You read Deleuze and Guattari. It's ADIEU LACAN. You get too dependent on analysis because you just love hearing yourself speak and filling space. Maybe it's time to ADIEU LACAN and get a hobby. But no. Today, ADIEU LACAN, Bye to Our Boy, is the title of a film. So it is a film episode, which is in 2 parts. So brace yourselves. First, we watched it. We kind of mulled over our thoughts and questions. It's kind of like a review, not just of the film, but review in the sense of reviewing what psychoanalysis and Lacan are about a little more generally, so you can get caught up.
Yeah.
And then the second half, we actually got the director of the film and writer-director of the film to come on and answer some of those questions that we had about his depiction of Lacan on the silver screen. The only depiction I've actually seen of Lacan on the silver screen. So it's one of the few.
And that's the first director we've talked to, I believe. Is it?
Oh, yeah.
We've definitely never...
I think I would have remembered talking to another director.
Outside of our comfort zone, but inside of our intellectual curiosity.
Yeah. So if you're looking at the length of this episode and not sure whether you want to commit, I think you do. We mashed what could have been 2 episodes into 1 here. So I don't know how you listen to podcasts. If you're driving, make sure it's a long drive. If you're at the business factory, make sure you don't have to pause it for your boss. And if you're trying to put on something boring while you fall asleep, well, fuck you.
Well, if you're curious about what a psychoanalytic treatment session, set of sessions, what a psychoanalytic treatment regime looks like, this film actually fills in this complete, almost lack of any kind of representations of the psychoanalysis process. The clinical psychoanalysis process that Lacan and others would have been involved in. So this is an awesome film. It fills in a gap, actually. I mean, what if you were like The Sopranos, right? You saw that depiction. Well, this one is even more realistic, and there's a lot there. There's a lot of depth. There's Easter eggs of all sorts, not only of French statues and things, but also of Lacanian ideas. If you're familiar with Lacan a little bit, you might spot a few things in there. It's really a smorgasbord, I think.
Yeah, links in the show notes if you want to watch it before listening to this. But it was the source material on which the film is based was written by an actual analysand of Lacan. So there's some degree of accuracy here.
Yeah, Betty Milan fictionalized her experience of psychoanalysis, and this film is based on that, which ironically makes it feel very realistic and very, very, true to what a Lacanian psychotherapist would do, right?
And although it is not 100% spoiler-free, we don't really give too much away, and I guess it's not even really the type of film where giving away plot has much effect on the experience anyway.
It's true. I was actually thinking about that because the director himself ended up kind of letting slip a bunch of spoilers that I think in our review we made like a concerted effort to not talk about. Like, I think maybe like 1 or 2 things. And then as he was saying that, I kind of did realize, I thought to myself, I was like, well, it's true. This is the kind of film that like you're not really waiting exactly. It's about like watching this process unfold in front of you and like whether you, I can't imagine like whether you know certain things happen or not, it will make much of a difference to your enjoyment of the film. So
yeah, if you see a lineup of people waiting to go see this film in a theater or something, shouting out the ending is not going to ruin it like it would a Thor movie.
Exactly.
Or something like that, right?
And if you do see a lineup of people waiting to see this film, you should probably go hang out with them because they're probably cool.
Yeah, if they're interested in Lacan, which I have been, and the research I did for this episode kind of brought that back, so it's not, that's nice.
So without further ado, okay, why did the unconscious do that? Without further ado,
that wasn't in your script.
No, I was reading the word adieu when I said that, which is why funny. It came out. Without further ado, because it's the title on my point form. Here is us from 2 weeks ago. Oh, yeah. This is the one other thing. We recorded it 2 weeks ago, so I used a shit mic instead of this mic. So forgive me that. I'm a perfectionist when it comes to my mics. Couldn't use my good one. Anyway, bad mic, then good mic. Us again from 2 weeks after we recorded the first one. Joined by Richard Ledes, the writer-director of Adieu Lacan. So we hope you enjoy this entry into the fantasy world of cinema. And thank you very much for listening.
And without much more adieu about nothing.
Adieu.
Adieu.
Well, the face-to-face is over. Sarajeva no longer needs to look at me. She can lie down and listen to herself. It's a victory. People live their lives without listening to themselves. With a tin ear. Some even die without ever listening to themselves. Eternally deaf to their own speech, to their own body, which screams rather than talks. A deafness that in itself is enough to justify psychoanalysis. If it still needs to be justified.
All right, listeners, we are in different time zones. And Pills is without his regular recording equipment. So if it sounds a little funky, forgive me. But
yeah.
I'm recording on vacation.
Because that's how important it is.
Yeah, you just sound further away.
You do sound further away.
I'm not. I'm right here, boys.
West Coast.
Yeah, it is.
Anyway, we got a double header. I think we're probably going to mash these two episodes together. And if that doesn't end up working out, then you'll never hear this audio anyway.
Cut, cut, cut.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll have to find out how to pronounce his last name. Eric, did you find out?
No, that interview is in French and it was just a snippet. I have to do more research.
So we'll say Richard Ledes or Richard Ledes.
Yeah.
Just cut around the right one.
But as we know from the film as well, your identity is not in what you call yourself in any case. It's in what you do not call yourself.
True.
So if you're wondering what we're talking about, we watched an indie film. I could say a very indie film called Adieu Lacan.
Yeah, and it stars David Patrick Kelly as Jacques Lacan, who is like a fairly well-known, or he's kind of one of those actors that like you wouldn't know him by name, but if you saw him, you might recognize him because he's been in like a bunch of stuff. I think he was in from the same. I always forget the name for some reason because I wasn't like that big of a fan of it. It's the same director as Mulholland Drive, that show that like had a comeback.
Oh, Twin Peaks, right?
Yeah, Twin Peaks. So he was in that and a few other things.
He's been in Gossip Girl.
Was he?
Was he?
Some other stuff. Maybe that it could just be a couple shows. I don't know if it was a whole season or the whole show. Could have been just a cameo.
He definitely resembles Lacan as well.
He does. He had a convincing French intellectual aesthetic, if that makes sense. Even though the movie was in English.
A Lacanian gestalt, for sure.
Chomping on the cigar always helps with the French aesthetic.
Exactly.
Anyway, we're not going to do anything like a regular film review, which is, what did you think about the acting? What did you think about the blocking? Because none of us know shit about that, and we have no problem admitting it. So maybe we have opinions, but those are probably not the ones that we're going to spend too much time on.
Yeah.
We do have all opinions on Lacan, however.
Oh, I just have to drop in one more thing that David Patrick Kelly is in, probably a role people may be familiar with. If you've seen a little movie from the 70s called The Warriors, it's this dystopian movie about all these gangs in New York. And he plays the guy that delivers that famous line, you know, "Warriors, come out and play."
Really?
That was him?
That's David fucking Patrick Kelly. He plays what's the character's name?
Luther.
Luther in The Warriors. Yeah. The crazy guy who
that's so funny. Apparently, according to Wikipedia,
the main characters.
According to Wikipedia, that might have been his first ever film role, which is pretty cool. So
that now I recognize him totally from hearing about that role.
So that puts, I mean, so you can see he's, you know, he's an actor who's been, you know, who's been in the business for a long time, can say. But I will also say, like, I know we're going to talk about Lacan. I mean, I did enjoy the film. You know, I don't know if that's just because I'm interested in Lacanian theory, right? I can't say whether or not people who don't know about Lacanian theory will find it interesting, but I liked it for that reason alone, because it's pretty rare to find a film that actually, like, focuses on, you know, in this case, it's really his practitioner side, his analyst side, not necessarily his theoretical side, but still, you know, for me, someone who influenced the way I think about the world and people. So to see a film that sort of depicts this figure, it was enjoyable. And I think it was successful in a few different ways.
Yeah, there's enough Easter eggs in there, definitely. I'm not a Lacanian, but I am, in theory, adjacent to that sort of thing. So there's enough Easter eggs in there for you to keep you happy, right? I think there's Easter eggs, references. Like, at one point, there is Henri Lefebvre's book, The Differentialist Manifesto. Oh, yeah. There is, like, Sophocles. There was, I think at one point, the administrator in the office brought in a book by Alain de Botton or something like that and set it on his desk.
That would have been out of time.
Maybe you meant someone else. Alain Badiou?
I'm probably getting the name wrong.
There's one by Rousseau, I noticed, the noble savage brought up, and it was in a book on the desk. So there's Easter eggs.
There's definitely Easter eggs.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff in there. Sometimes you have to pause and go back and, like, check them out, but they're there. They're interesting.
Anyway, I just want to say, you can get this thing on, I think, the Apple Movies app and the Amazon Prime app. It might cost you like $4 or whatever it is. But you're not everyone's going to like this movie. I thought we should add that. If your favorite film is Infinity War, this may not be the film for you. It all takes place in one room. It's a 1-to-1 aspect ratio. It's black and white. So it's the artsy fartsy bits. So if you're into Lacan, I think you're going to like it a lot. But if you are the type of person who needs to be constantly stimulated,
a casual infotainment consumer, maybe not.
It really has, and I think this was intentional. It feels like a play. Like, it's got that kind of, like, theater feel to it. And in fact, as I found out actually in the credits, I was like, oh, it is actually based on a novel and then a play written by Betty Milan, who is a Brazilian Lacanian psychoanalyst. And she actually was analyzed by Lacan in the 70s, late 70s, mid 70s. And the novel and the play, I think, are loosely based on her analysis, though they're not. I from what I read, it's not like a full out, like, biographical account of her. I mean, in the film, at least, the name is changed. It's not Betty Milan, right? It's another woman. And we'll get to that in a little bit. So it does have that kind of feel. Like that kind of theater feel when you're watching it. I remember I actually kept thinking, I was like, wow, this just, like, because the whole thing, as Pill says, takes place, pretty much the whole thing takes place in the one room, in the analyst analyzand, kind of like back and forth.
And I don't envy the task of the writer or the filmmaker who has to make Lacan's writing and methods understandable and palatable to a wider audience than they normally would be. I mean, after this, I went back and read. I went back and read The Mirror Stage, and I'm just like, oh my fucking god! Like, I read it like 8 years ago, and now reading it again today. I've read it a couple times, but I feel like I understand a little tiny bit more of it every time. But, like, I still couldn't explain. I couldn't just sit down and explain it to somebody. It's really difficult. So the way I think the balance was, like, perfect between a kind of drama you can follow, a story you can kind of follow, and dropping in those things that, if you're sort of in the know and you are familiar with Lacanian psychoanalysis, you get the sense that there is a solid theoretical understanding behind this film. There's just enough in there to indicate that, but not too much for the uninitiated to just become completely lost in imagos and letters of the unconscious and all that stuff.
And it's not too explainy. And what I kept going back and forth with is, like, we think we know Lacan because he read his books. But this is someone who, like, spoke to Lacan, was analyzed by him. And then we can ask, who is Lacan? Is it the author? You know, no. Is it the analyst? No. So it's giving aspects of the same persona that we ascribe one name to that's really not one name. So I thought it was interesting to be like, is this her experience in analysis that made that wrote this? Is this the writer of the film that added this in there? Is this someone who's familiar with Lacan's work after the fact, checking it and dropping it in? So it was interesting trying to figure out, you know, what's unsaid, as the movie says, and Lacan himself quote says something to the effect in there of the analyst is always acting but pretending not to be.
Right. And it's worth mentioning, too, that the director, Richard Ledes or Leeds, God, we're going to have to find out how to pronounce that last name. But he actually has a PhD in, I believe it's some kind of like history of psychology. I wasn't exactly clear. Like, I saw him mention it in an interview that I watched, but on his own website, I don't know.
Well, you can ask him in
We will find out.
Hour in fake time.
Exactly. So I will find out exactly. But the point is, he has a real understanding, like an academic understanding of Lacan, I think, based on that background.
But anyway, I just wanted to say it was really refreshing because of the depictions of especially psychoanalysis and therapy in, you know, popular media. Or even academics, I could say, in popular media. They're either like savant geniuses who are antisocial. The only thing they care about is their object of study. And then especially when psychoanalysis is depicted in film or TV, it's, you know, tell me about your childhood with some like caricature of Freud. But this shows the method as someone who's done analysis. It really shows the method and it picks up on the right parts, like where there's those fallings in language. I think at one point she says language trips and falls over itself. And then you as the analysand are thinking, why did I say that? And then that's the thing that's in your mind for the rest of the week.
Yeah, so I don't know. Should we, Pills, did you want to talk a little bit more about Lacanian analytic method before we get into kind of giving a very like brief setup of what the movie is about?
Yeah, we should actually, we haven't talked about Lacan directly for a while, so maybe we should refresh on that. Like, as opposed to the other psychoanalysts, Melanie Klein, who deals often with childhood and play and that kind of thing, and Freud, I think everybody knows Freud.
Carl Jung and Melanie Klein.
Yeah, and the ego.
Let's not mention Carl Jung. Let's not bring him up. But anyway, the thing that Lacan is most different from his colleagues in that respect, and even the Psychoanalytic Association that he got kicked out of / left, is this emphasis on language. And this is something I think the film got very fascinatingly correct.
Mm-hmm.
Focusing on her words, her reflections on her words. And there's also a few idiosyncrasies of Lacan himself that come out in the film, like him ending sessions abruptly. Sometimes the sessions would be 10 minutes long and he'd just say, okay, we're done, I'll see you next time, and then demand the same payment for every session. And he's talked about this too, this demanding payment thing is you cannot have a what appears to be a friendship with an analysand. The analyst must be the figure that is outside. This is a paid relationship, and there's stories of him like sitting while the analysand is speaking, you know, pouring their heart out over their trauma, he's sitting there like counting the francs and clicking the coins on his desk, and they go, you're not listening to me, and then he'll go, okay, the session's done. Yeah. But the whole point of this, you're not listening to me, I guess the mindset to these days would be, I'm a consumer, I have paid for your time, you owe me this time. And then if Lacan is the genius that many of us think he is, then he's trying to provoke that response to say, look, I'm not your dad, I'm not your buddy, I don't owe you anything, and just because you paid me doesn't define my responses to you.
Yeah.
Which is different from a therapist, right? I often bash therapy as opposed to psychoanalysis for specifically that reason.
Yeah, for sure. And I think there's a like the part about the variable length sessions too is this idea too about like that if I think like part of the theory behind it is like if the analysand has this idea of like, okay, I've got like 50 minutes or whatever, then like their unconscious is going to kind of like set themselves up so that they can protect like kind of the insights around it within the framework of that time. So if you say ahead of time, like, okay, like the timing is going to be what it is, then like your unconscious can't adapt to the length of the session. And therefore, the analyst instead in the Lacanian context can kind of intervene and stop. And I think it's a form of intervention to basically get the analysand to reflect. So if there's like a moment, a puncture kind of that happens, or like, I guess what some might call like a potential breakthrough, at least from the analyst's perspective, then they can just stop the session and sort of force the analysand to sit with what happened and how it ended. That's the theory behind it.
I don't know.
I say I don't know and you get up?
True.
You're going to leave me with I don't know. I can't stand this way of ending a session, this sudden and brutal interruption.
100 francs.
I didn't withdraw any money.
Then go and get it.
I've heard less charitable interpretations and stories of like, you know, look, Lacan collecting 100 francs from, you know, like 20 patients a day because he's having these like short, like 10 minute sessions and that it's like a money grab. So, you know, there's a way of interpreting it cynically. I think the theory behind it is kind of interesting, but I think you would have to like for that to be the case, it would have to be the case that sometimes you'd have sessions that would go on for 3 hours, right? Because like it would keep going. So it'd have to be variable both ways, which apparently it was. I don't know for sure. But.
Of the three of us, I probably may have the most kind of stereotypical illusions about what goes on in psychoanalytic therapy. But my basic notion is that it's all sort of based on, again, the Freudian talking cure, the idea that you get the person to speak. You get the patient, the analysand, to speak. And the analyst acts, you know, plays that role, but and acts like a blank canvas, whatever background you need. In a certain sense, whatever psychodrama is working itself out through your language and through the narratives you're telling about yourself, the analyst is supposed to be almost like a blank canvas or ready to adopt any sort of oppositional roles that emerge in the sort of so it's like if it's a problem with a kind of primordial father or mother or any kind of thing like that, the analyst is ready there to be that canvas you need on which to paint your sort of, I guess, like paint your unconscious in a certain way, but at least that the talking cure anyway, it seems like the basic thing to bring up first.
Yeah, I had an analyst and I kind of asked, why do you even do the laying down thing? Why do you lay down on a couch instead of like talk face to face? And he described it as you need to both be looking at the same thing, which is not really the thing. You need to be like, they're a functionary where you bounce your language off of, but it's so that you can see the thing that you're talking about, and the positionality is supposed to help with that, which is, again, I think it's unique to psychoanalysis, the laying on the couch, as opposed to other forms of therapy, like cognitive behavioral therapy.
Definitely.
But you can also see there what the symbolic imaginary triad, how they show their functions and the purpose of analysis, because it's not what do you not know about yourself that you have to learn, but it's what do you know about yourself that you don't want to know? Or what do you know about yourself that you want to pretend that you don't know? And that's where the loop is, the lying loop, where you're lying to yourself about what you already know. So yeah, in my experience, you learn what you know you don't want to know rather than learning what you don't know.
Yeah, for sure. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to add to that. Say there's a certain thing that the analyst needs to do in those situations is ferret out avoidance And when you're trying to avoid the issues and you're substituting some other less important issue for the real issue, when you're talking about one thing in order to avoid talking about something else, which I feel like, you know, that film made me feel like, you know, someone who's into theory, that's what I'm doing all the time, is avoiding the real problems because I'm talking about theory and never really, you know, but what, like, am I listening to myself? Am I listening to my body? Like, I'm putting myself in the audiences that Lacan is speaking to when I'm reading his papers, the expert audience, but I never put myself in the position of the analysand to think of, like, am I really, you know, am I living out these principles, or am I just sort of learning them at a distance and otherwise, you know, persisting in my otherwise repressive ways?
Yeah, I think what's...
There's a great line from the film where she goes, or she says to Lacan while she's being analyzed, I don't even know why I'm in France. And then there's a voiceover where he says, she doesn't know why she's in France because she doesn't listen to herself speak.
Speak.
I don't really know why I'm in France.
She doesn't know why, because she doesn't listen to
herself.
Yeah,
that's exactly the line I was thinking of, that he kind of goes on in his monologue, which I love those little almost internal Lacanian monologues. I thought those were crucial, but that's just how it made me feel, like, man, I do this all the fucking time. I'm probably a mess. If I did psychoanalysis now, the person would probably just be like, nah, you're too far gone. Sorry, buddy. We can't train you at this age.
I actually think it might be worth just kind of like giving a brief setup of like what happens in the film, because I think actually I kind of decided as I was listening to you both talk that it's worth kind of telling the audience, okay, so the movie is about this woman, Sariema, right, who went to France from Brazil to get analysis from Lacan. And like the basic setup is, I think she had two miscarriages and had an issues with her. I think, I don't know if it was her boyfriend or her husband. I forget if they were actually married or not, but they tried to have children, and that like led to a kind of crisis, and like, without spoiling it. So that's basically like the setup of why she's there. But I did also want to say something about Lacanian psychoanalytic technique. You know, one of the things, Eric, you were saying, you were talking about how the psychoanalyst acts as kind of like a black canvas. And I've got here, I've been looking and seeing the film made me want to revisit Bruce Fink's A Clinical Introduction to the Lacanian Psychoanalysis, because I think he goes over some really like key aspects of just like the technique itself, right? So one of the things he talks about is like that the analyst, and I think this in a way shows up in the film, has to combat this idea of like the subject supposed to know, which means like when you go into analysis, I think there's a tendency of the analyst to want to think of the analyst as some kind of figure of authority, right? That they have knowledge that they're going to share with you. And that's actually like not what the analyst is supposed to do, right? The only authority, Fink talks about this, if there is an authority to be respected in the analytic setting, it is the manifestations of the unconscious in the analysand, slips, mistakes, expressions of surprise, and so on, right? So that fits into what you were just saying, that quote in the movie, right, where he says, oh, she would know, you know, if she heard herself talk, because the authority, right, the actual authority is their own unconscious, their own speaking. And I also thought it was interesting in the film when he says, I think he comments in one of the voiceover parts, the Lacan character, you know, that people very rarely, some people go through their whole life, right, like not actually hearing themselves speak, not actually mm-hmm. hearing themselves, right? And it's like the analyst setting is meant really to be where you can hear yourself speak. And I think that fits into what you were saying, Pills, about why is it that analysts want you to sit on the couch not facing them, right? Because if you are seeing the other person, and this is another thing that comes up in the book, by the way, if you are seeing your analyst as a person in front of you, right, then that can distract you from just listening to yourself, right? So like by not looking at someone, there's more chance, this is at least the theory behind it, right? There's more chance you're going to hear the words you're using. You're going to hear yourself talk, right? And I think this is where the psychoanalytic theory or the Lacanian theory of like the imaginary comes in. If you look face to face, you get all kinds of weird imaginary ideas, fantasies about the other person. And this is another thing that has to be combated in analysis, right? That, you know, thinking about the analyst as a person can get in the way, right? You start imagining
as an other. If exactly. you're thinking about what they're thinking of you, then you're not hearing yourself.
That's exactly.
Exactly right.
Exactly. Exactly. So that's one of another things that they're always combating, right? Is like you have to make sure you, in fact, you have to, the goal of the analyst is to be an other, but like not another person, like the capital O other, as opposed to, which is the other in yourself, right? To be able to hear yourself.
I don't know if we have any psychoanalysis cynics in the audience, but one thing that struck me was how easy it would be to see this all as just a grift. Because the only thing that Lacan, or one of the only things Lacan says, except for a few probing questions, are, you know, go on, continue speaking.
Yeah.
Speak more.
I'm listening. And then what else?
And then collects his $100 at the end of the day. So it's totally like, oh, this is the easiest job ever. You sit there and ask someone to speak. But I guess it's what separates someone who's capable and good at it is, can you push into that direction or not? Because if you're just looking at it from the outside, it almost seems like, well, this is the easiest grift ever.
Yeah.
It's the easiest, like, self-help guru thing. You don't even have to give advice.
Yeah, you can't even tell if he's listening or not. Like, it's, or like, you know, it can almost sound like, but I think that really is the task, to like listen and to know when to intervene. But for sure, it can definitely seem, I could see why it could seem like a grift. I will say, on the, like, I don't know, I wouldn't say that I'm a psychoanalysis cynic, but I have been somewhat persuaded by, so my stepdad's a psychiatrist, and he, and I don't know if I've ever talked about this on the podcast, but he's a psychiatrist, and he started off training to be a Freudian analyst, and he was in analysis, but he felt, I don't know if he would say that it was like he thought it was a grift, but what he didn't like about it was he felt like the method was getting in the way of the humanity of it, which maybe is the point, right, of analysis, right? You're supposed to dehumanize in this sense, right? Like that, all the stuff we were just talking about. But he was persuaded by reading a lot of the research. There was like a pretty famous, I think, research paper in psychiatry, or maybe it was psychology, about how the most successful therapists of every stripe were the ones where the people who had self-reported the best outcomes of their therapy, and this was like a bunch of different types of therapists with all kinds of methods, right? Whether it's cognitive behavioral therapy, whether it's Lacanian analysis, whether it's, you know, humanists, whatever it is. And he just said that, like, you know, there wasn't really like that good evidence to say that one had better outcomes than the other. But what they did find was that the patients who said that who had the best self-reported outcomes had therapists who they felt like heard them and were listening to them, and they felt like some kind of like rapport, like they felt like they were being heard. Didn't matter if they're Freudians, didn't matter if they were like, you know, cognitive behavioral therapists. So he was kind of persuaded that, you know, the method doesn't really matter. It's kind of like the approach that you take. And he himself adopts kind of like a grab bag of different methods that kind of like make sense to him. And I will say that it seems intuitive to me that psychoanalysts are maybe at greatest risk. Maybe this is wrong, but at a certain risk of almost fetishizing their method, where they're just like, where they follow it like procedurally. And like, don't really pay the attention. It's like they're paying more attention to the method than they are the person that's there with them. And so I don't know. I mean, again, this is coming from someone who's never studied psychology or like practiced it, but that seems right to me.
Well, one charge that's sometimes levied against Lacan is that a larger proportion of his analysants committed suicide. And there is also a pushback to that, which is to say, or his supporters say, that he also took on the most difficult, hopeless, quote unquote, cases.
Right.
That, you know, that would probably be the outcome anyway. So I don't know. There is a debate about that, about whether he was ethical, or whether the method itself is ethical. But can you imagine? I can't imagine what I would do if I heard my analyst in the back of the room like counting the money that I gave him, just being like, dude.
Yeah, there's a part in the film too.
I deserve love.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You know, and I think I often thought to myself that I wonder if, like, I've always wanted to be in analysis, just because I think it would be interesting. But I think,
why,
you know,
haven't you?
I, I feel like there are probably a lot of people who are like really suffering a lot. And it does strike me that like psychoanalysis would be really hard for those people, I think, because it's just like, I think it's like extremely challenging because it does force you to confront yourself. And I think the problem is so many people who go into therapy like are have such a hard time doing that already. And then you go to this method that like forces you to do this and like doesn't hold your hand at all. Like it doesn't surprise me that it just wouldn't work for those kinds of people, I guess. Like I feel like you have to already have some kind of like a stronger constitution in yourself to be able to handle what it asks of you.
Well, there's always a reason. Like if you are in analysis, there's a reason for that. I mean, unless you got committed or something. So sure. You know, I guess, even to show up there, you know that something's wrong and believe that it can be fixed. Now, it's usually not the thing that you think is wrong going in there. For example, in this film, she goes in because she's having marital problems and comes out and it's a different problem. I won't spoil the ending, but it's something else that she had to realize about herself. But what I really also liked about this film, as opposed to, I don't know, marriage counseling, is there's a definite end point in analysis. Like now you're finished. And that doesn't mean that you are ever like truly finished in terms of growing as a person and all that. But if there's one thing that is the trauma point or the hinge point that you keep cycling, or the repetition that we speak about with reference to Lacan, if you keep repeating that one event, then there is a definite point at which you realize and cease the repetition, which is the goal. And there might be, if you have multiple traumas, you might have to do multiple routes through that repetition. But I thought it was a good point to end on, because the analysand realizes that she got what she needed from it, not that he decided that it was over.
Yeah, although what's that?
Yeah. Didn't he kind of decide, though? Didn't he kind of decide at one point in the film where he's just like, you got what you needed, like you figured it out?
He said that in voiceover, actually.
Oh, okay, you're right.
He didn't. He's like, she's done, but he didn't let her finish until she realized she was done.
Oh, you're right. You're right. You're totally right. I should have been paying better attention.
Yeah, it's like he noticed the breakthrough happened, but it hadn't quite sunk in yet. So it's like, okay, it has to continue. Can't stop too early, because then maybe it will regress. But I was going to ask about that repetition. Because I got the sense, you know, I've read some Guattari too, and he kind of emphasizes this aspect of psychoanalysis, is it helps you get past blockages, right? When you get blocked up, you get stuck, I'm guessing as a result of some kind of trauma, and you constantly just repeat that trauma over and over again, and you can't move past it, and it stops you from moving forward in your life. It stops you from, in some cases, you know, being able to become a mother, right? Releasing some kind of tension that's affecting you that you had between you and your father that is continuing to be repeated. And I get this sense also of war trauma, right? A lot of psychoanalytic theory has drawn from returning soldiers, and they find that they tend to live their traumatic experiences over and over and over again, that kind of repetition compulsion. So there's a certain sense that psychoanalysis is about helping you get past these blockages and allow you to, I mean, I like these lines about allowing you to take control of your past rather than become a victim of it, allowing you to write your own story rather than kind of being a slave to history, which is when you're trying to repress it, because the repressed always returns. The ancestors never, you know, stay dead. They always come back. Yeah, that's what psychoanalysis seems to be about in a very broad sense.
Yeah, that was a good moment when he says something about how, because she's sort of the analysand, she's resisting like a certain, or at least she's questioning, like, why is there like this obsession with going back and like look examining these things? And I think he says something like, you know, those who aren't aware of the past are going to reenact it all the time. Although I wonder, you know, do you think there's something, this is something I've often thought about, like psychoanalysis, or it's like a critique I've wondered about, which is like, Is it too rationalistic in this sense, in the sense that it's like, okay, if you just have like knowledge of something, somehow it won't bother you anymore, right? It's like, so it like, it almost like, it almost overly cognizes trauma or cognizes psychological disturbances by being like, well, all you need to know is be aware of it. And then somehow that's going to like make you better. I don't know.
I have an answer to that though, because I realized kind of the repetition that I was doing through analysis. I realized the repetition I was doing, and I still do it, right?
Right.
It's not like I'm suddenly a better person.
Right.
But the difference is subjectively, then you don't feel trapped by it. At least when you screw up the next time, you can say, look, I know why this happened.
So you have a story to go with it, whereas yeah. before... Whereas but I
you,
guess, but,
then you're accountable for it. And then you can like, then if you like, if you fuck up your relationship with somebody, then you can apologize to them for it, having known what was your responsibility there.
Well, I guess because in the past you would have maybe, or someone, not necessarily you, would have just had all kinds of like rationalizations and defense mechanisms and wouldn't have been able to see the core of it.
It would have been repetition without knowledge, whereas now it would be repetition plus knowledge. So I don't think it doesn't solve your behavior, but it solves the repetition, which is the unconsciousness of your behavior.
Yeah, there's a certain way in which it's a symbolic resolution of a real conflict. And in psychoanalysis, the real conflict is always, you know, inherent in the constitution of any subject. There's a kind of real at the core of it, which is a kind of fracture or a split, the split subject. Which I guess the non-knowledge of that, or the attempts at repression or cheap solutions, is going to manifest as repetition compulsions, which manifest in, you know, in your language, in your speech, in your symbolic life, your social life in a certain sense. I think this is also a big concept in like Claude Lévi-Strauss and Friedrich Jameson, the ideas of symbolic resolution to real conflicts. And I guess psychoanalysis seems to take on a version of that as well, with its focus on language and symbols and signs.
One thing, I don't think this is a spoiler, and you can let me know and I'll cut it out if it is. But the very end of the film, the final question that Lacan wants her to answer, because we've kind of given her fictional biography mm-hmm. a little bit. She comes from Brazil and goes to Paris, and she thinks that she wants to go study with Lacan because he's this man of renown and a very famous analyst. But the thing that he gets her to admit that he suspected all along is that she wanted to do psychoanalysis not in her mother tongue, which would be Brazilian Portuguese. But she wanted to do it in French, and she kind of realizes that that's a defense mechanism, which is her final realization that makes her realize, okay, I can go home now. Because she was defending herself against the trauma of her mother tongue and her ancestry and a bunch of other parts of the film that we're not going to spoil for you. But that's I love that language bit. That language was ultimately the problem, because that is Lacan.
Exactly.
Language is ultimately the problem.
Exactly. Yeah. And there's a good part without spoiling it. There's a good scene where she reports having hallucinations, and the things she's having hallucinations on, she comes to discover like there's a word that like is standing in for something else in her life. And like that's a very like Lacanian moment in the film. And I thought that was depicted pretty well. The displacement.
The displacement in the symbolic and in the words, not what they mean.
Exactly.
It would be much more Freudian to be like, okay, what does this hallucination represent, rather than, oh, it's actually just a word.
Exactly. It's about the language part of it. And I think that the whole part about the mother tongue is interesting, because I think there's also a scene in the movie where Lacan suggests, he's like, because pretty early in the film, I think she expresses, the female character, she expresses frustration with like not being understood in France. The film is in English, but it's supposed to be like in France, obviously. And then he kind of suggests, well, I can get you like a Portuguese analyst, right? And then she's like very hostile. Yeah. She threatens to leave analysis, basically. And she has a rationalization for it, right? Which is well, I'm Brazilian. These are Portuguese. So it's going to be different. It's not even going to be the same. Like, what's the point? I came here. So it's funny. And then, of course, at the end of the film, you realize, and these are light spoilers, but like, whatever. I think it actually, I don't think it matters.
Light spoil, but it's also this, the center of Lacan that everybody knows is the unconscious is structured like a language. So it's not just, whereas Freudian psychoanalysis, and I might be wrong about this, but Freudian psychoanalysis, it seems to me, is like, okay, what does a wolf represent? What does a rat represent? These different analysands that Freud had, it's like we need to get to the meaning of the image. Whereas in Lacan, the meaning is in like the phoneme. That's what I mean. It's in just the phoneme that represents something else unconsciously, because your unconscious is much more attuned to these minor differences in language that we forget, but you remember it as a kid. And like I said, I'm on vacation now. So I got like nephews who are learning how to talk, and their slips of these phonemes are really interesting to me. Not that I'm psychoanalyzing them, but their little slips of phoneme are interesting to me because we forgot that we learned that. Yeah. This is one of the pillsisms that I always repeat. You forgot how difficult it was to learn it. It took you years of practicing every single day. And anything that we do for years of practicing every single day, we're going to forget how difficult it was at the beginning. But in this film, at least, it has a great example, and probably the original source material as well, of how, like, that's not natural in that sense. It's not easy, and you build up these associations where you can slip from one word into another, and that's where language stumbles over itself, because your unconscious is structured like a language.
Yeah, that's something I really liked about this film, is that Sariema's sort of, her being Brazilian and her focus, the focus on her language and her culture, is in a way convenient at foregrounding what you just said, Pills, because in Lacanian, the Lacanian unconscious foregrounds the unconscious as being structured like a language, much more so than it does the unconscious, the Freudian unconscious, being a kind of a repository of instinctive drives. And even, you know, he kind of opens up one of his articles, or he says this in one of his articles, you know, the psychoanalytic experience discovers in the unconscious the whole structure of language. And that's language in the sense that Saussure, Ferdinand de Saussure, would use the term language existing as an entire total structure, which as you learn and incorporate language, you become like a kind of microcosm of Long. And so, you know, he says, I've alerted informed minds, which means his expert audiences, I guess, to the extent to which the notion that the unconscious is merely the seat of the instincts will have to be rethought. So it's not instinctive, but it's that foregrounding, that language element. And in a sense, her situation was convenient for foregrounding that aspect of Lacanian psychoanalysis. Because if he was just performing psychoanalysis on another French person, right, you wouldn't necessarily have, it would, I think just maybe filmically and directorially, it would be a little harder to foreground the importance of language in Lacanian psychoanalysis. But I thought that was a really good solution to bringing that out. Because like I said, you know, Lacan really incorporates, you know, Saussure and modern linguistics into his methods.
Right, as compared to Jung, because Jung's like library of archetypes is purely imaginary, and he almost gives no credence to language except as a vehicle to convey the imaginary. Whereas, like you said, the Saussure Lacan French tradition is very focused on the language itself. Not what it represents, but as what it does as a machine, as a function.
Yeah. So like, you know, Freud's mechanisms of the unconscious, the way that the unconscious works for Freud is through condensation and displacement, right? Where a symbol can acquire a kind of cathectic or, you know, emotional investment. And then displacement is the second mechanism, which then takes that condensed energy and switches it for a different symbol. So you have this kind of looping condensation, displacement, And in linguistic terms, that's metaphor and metonymy. Metaphor is condensation, metonymy is displacement. And then that links into the Saussurean sign of the signifier and the signified and the relationship between those two and the ultimate sort of importance of the signifier over the signified, because that's how, you know, the unconscious works. The unconscious is structured like a language. Let's take on linguistics and look at metaphor and metonymy and see how metaphors in dreams and metonyms. I mean, metonyms are, you know, using a part to represent a whole kind of thing, and metaphors replacing one whole with another sort of thing, right?
I think I'd like to bring back some of this structural analysis of language to the public discourse these days, because everyone's extremely obsessed with the way words are used, what words represent, and not really what words are anymore.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. Do you have an example in mind? I mean, you're right.
No, I don't. Not today.
Not today. Yeah. I mean, that's good.
Well, you know, the interesting part about the return to German idealism from a psychoanalytic perspective is that you have to read the language stuff back into German idealism, because it's really not a central element until maybe you get to Hegel, maybe not even Hegel. Maybe the Romantics make a much bigger deal of language. And, you know, by the time you're at Lacan, language, linguistics, and the Saussurean understanding of language is crucial. It's been deeply incorporated into the psychoanalytic method.
Yeah, no, I think so. And I mean, earlier, because I was kind of mentioning that some critiques are you can get too caught up in the method, but I think that's probably true of other things too, like cognitive behavioral therapy is like a very specific method as well. I don't know. I just don't know enough, I guess. But I'm just kind of just like giving secondhand earlier, like what my psychiatrist stepdad has said in the past. He's not particularly a fan of cognitive behavioral therapy either.
Hey, one of the big stereotypes about psychoanalysis is that the ego, the damaged ego of the patient, is supposed to be replaced by the perfect ego of the analyst, which. I think Lacan actually mentions that is actually kind of how the American ego psychologists treat it in some ways, and that it's a very flawed method because the analyst is also imperfect. That's what you were saying earlier about, like, we go in expecting answers because this is the subject supposed to know. And we want answers. Why? And I think Sarajevo brings this up a little bit. It's like always more questions and never answers from you. Just more questions. It's almost as if you're more interested in what I'm not saying than what I am saying. And he just goes, "That's true." Session over. It's like, whoa.
And then he stops. Yeah, he stops it at that moment too, like of the whole variable length sessions, right? She asked that question. He's like, "You're right." And then he stops it, right? Because he wants her to sit with that thought, right?
Yeah. She's like, why are you getting up? This brought up a question that I really want to ask the director. And it's, I don't know that I don't like it. It just seemed very puzzling to me, is that Lacan, well, both of them have their voiceover. So they're speaking, right? They're speaking to each other. And one thing that a film can do that like a play can't, unless you have maybe a soliloquy or something like that.
Pre-recorded, yeah.
But they use voiceover to tell us what Lacan is thinking while he's analyzing. And I think at one point early on, I might be wrong about this, but I think she gets a voiceover as well for a little bit.
Yeah.
And I was wondering what you guys thought, because this to me, in a way, really disrupted the psychoanalytic experience of the movie, which is just, you know, psychoanalysis sessions. But to hear what he's thinking, I think it's really good for like a viewer's perspective, especially if you don't know what psychoanalysis is all about, is like, oh, this is the end goal that he's trying to get to. But there's an attempt using these voiceovers to subjectivize Lacan as well, which is exactly the opposite intention of the psychoanalytic session. So I wondered if you had any thoughts about, you know, like, is this a choice for the viewers? I think that's obvious. But did it change your experience of watching the puzzle of her repetition unfold? Or did it distract from that, maybe.
Yeah, you know, I think that is probably the one place where I had mixed feelings about the film. So I, on the one hand, I thought it was interesting and useful, especially there was like a couple moments, I'm trying to remember exactly what happened, where the voiceover to like what he's thinking and then to what she's thinking. And it's what's interesting about it is just like how different it is, how like they're how they're thinking totally past each other, kind of like how she's not picking up on what he's trying to do. And like, I think that what's good and useful about that is it's kind of like gives you an insight into like the difficulty of being an analyst, or like what the analyst is trying to do, and how like the analyst end can have a hard time picking up on that. But on the other hand, I think like from like a narrative perspective, I think what felt a little bit uneven to me about the film was that it seemed like it both was focusing much more on Sariema, but then there were like parts where, as you were saying, Pills, like subjectivizing Lacan. And because there are those scenes where he's on the phone talking to his doctor, right? Because like there's kind of like a subplot of how like Lacan himself is sick at the time, which he was. I think he died shortly after when the movie was taking place in the late 70s. And that part felt a little bit underdeveloped. Like it felt like the film wanted to give you some insight into who Lacan the person was and like what kind of struggles he was going through. And maybe that fits into like including the voiceovers of Lacan himself. But in general, it felt much less developed, underdeveloped compared to like what we get in, about into like Sariema, if that makes sense.
Right. I think I would agree with that and say either fully humanize him and show that he's like worried about his lunch and worried about his kid. And yeah, he's just a normal guy. But then he comes into the session and is no longer a normal guy because he has to function as the analyst there. Or keep them entirely separate, or just leave the subjectivizing of him out and keep him as this guru mystical figure. But I understand certainly why it was done, because if you don't, if you're not familiar with his writings and all this background stuff, then it becomes unclear why he's doing what he's doing.
Yeah, that's the thing.
And maybe it would be more interesting to be unclear with what he's doing, because the end result would be the same, right? But I don't know. I thought
it's hard.
I can't say whether or not I would have made it or not made it, but it was the one part that I thought stuck out to me as, I don't even want to say it was wrong. I don't want to say it was right. It was puzzling. I think it added a knot into the relationship that I wasn't expecting.
I agree. Yeah.
I have a very similar take. I have a bit of a half-baked take on this, about the Lacan voiceovers and what that gives us in the film, which I agree, I kind of wanted more. But in another sense, I thought that those were just kind of delicate notes that were put in there, that if we did get more, it might have ruined a bit of the... it would have ruined a little bit of the immersion in the main story. But what I really liked about it was it established... this is my take, anyway. It seemed to establish parallels between Lacan and the patient, right? Because Lacan is portrayed as refusing to get some kind of operation, right? That is supposedly he is unable to face his own death, and he's supposed to get some kind of operation done, but he doesn't want to live a life of pain. I don't know if I'm ruining too much going through all this, but this establishes a perfect parallel between Sariema, who is, for various reasons, using therapy in France and French to avoid the real problems and something about, you know, not getting an operation after the first miscarriage and that sort of thing came up. And this seemed to draw a direct parallel to Lacan, who's thinking about his own daughter and how she will be left without a father in the same way that Sariema kind of was, right? And he obviously doesn't want to leave his daughter with the same sort of emotional baggage that Sariema has to deal with. But he doesn't want to live a life of pain. This is creating another thing that you would need psychoanalysis for. He's unable to face his own death. Why? There's probably some other issue that he can't really get to on his own that is going on there. But it seemed not only to establish the kind of imperfectness of the analyst, but also it added this nice, like, sort of narrative kind of or thematic parallel to Sariema's own situation, which was that she was, you know, she's going to therapy, but there is a deep current of like avoidance driving the whole entire thing, this repression that he's got to ferret out. And so why are you doing this? Why are you avoiding talking about the real issues kind of thing? And, you know, you can see Lacan almost in the grips in his very old age, right? This is like the last, this took place from 1974 to 1977, which was less than 10 years before Lacan's real historical death. And so that's what I thought, again, another aspect that the Lacan voiceovers added anyway.
Just to build on that, there is a difference. Kind of what I said earlier about repetition plus knowledge is different. Because she didn't know why she refused treatment. But he did. And he said, I know this is what's expected of me. I know that the doctor wants me to do this and my daughter wants me to do this and everyone wants me to not be sick anymore. But I want to be sick. I don't know if you'd call that the same kind of refusal, but he's not being, I guess he has knowledge of the repetition that he's performing there, saying I'd rather be dead.
And it's in a way like the specter of a life in pain is preventing him from taking the chance at living a longer, healthy life. Maybe the operation would go fine. Doesn't matter. It's his kind of fantasy of living in pain that is now again blocking him up. And so Lacan probably himself needs psychoanalysis after this, if they ever do a sequel, which would not make sense, because this is a self-contained film.
That part has to be fictional. So I wonder, maybe we should ask the director what the purpose behind that was, or if we already got it.
Yeah,
The purpose of what? Yeah, I mean, I think like you're talking about what Eric was just saying, which I agree that that does seem like plausibly the intent of what he was up to. I think, you know, and this comes from someone who like doesn't fucking know like much about cinema. But I guess it struck me that like that if that was the attempt, maybe it wasn't 100% successful. But I also think that it's like we said at the beginning, like this is such a monumental task to make a film about Lacan that can actually capture some of the theory and practice in like a compelling way, which I think for the most part was actually quite successful. And then these like little things kind of like, it's just hard to know how the film would have come across if it tried to like develop that more. It might not, like, I'm trying to imagine how it could have been done as a non-filmmaker again, and I just don't know.
And it might just be like audience service too, which would, there's nothing wrong with that. Almost all of our films are pure audience service, and this one's clearly not.
I don't know how much longer we want to go, but there's one last little kind of thread that I don't know if we can untangle it. It was the gender thing that ran through it, right? Did you notice after the second meeting, he holds up a newspaper and he's reading from this newspaper. And funny enough, the newspaper faces the camera and it says in like big French headline,
oh, yeah,
Mao dead at 82 years old. Wasn't mentioned. Just interesting, funny.
And, there's a lot of Easter eggs like that.
Yeah, little historical references. But then on the other side of the paper, which he was looking at, Lacan was reading, it said heart has a gender. It was something about the heart having a gender and the difference. And he's kind of like musing to himself, oh, even the heart has a sex, right? And there's this sort of the strand of a kind of, you know, her desire to remain sexless and her body betraying her. Really played into obviously the issues with the father. The father wants all the affection for himself and leaves her unable to choose a substitute. I don't know if that's the right way to put it. But running even underneath that is her desire to be sexless. She was brought up almost in a boyish way, right? Like she's trained to be competitive. She was encouraged to do judo and compete for grants. Even her professional life is run over by this competitiveness. And she's there on a grant. The money she's using to pay him is some grant she's obtained to go to Paris and live there for 6 years or whatever it was and get psychoanalysis. But that gender thing is weird, because then it kind of comes up again later in the film as well. But that initial moment where it comes up with the heart having a gender and this sort of, you know, your biological sex betrays your fantasies in a certain way. I don't know if that's codified into psychoanalysis.
It is. And this is something I'm going to be very careful about choosing my words over, but it's an Easter egg again to one of the last things that Lacan wrote was, I think it's in one of the seminars. It's called Sexuation and Difference. And he got, you know, what we would call canceled by a lot of feminists for writing this. But he says in there, and it's very much misinterpreted. I have to let our audience know that. It's misinterpreted, but he says there is no female subject. The subject has a masculine signifier, and the female represents the lack of that. Now, immediately, you have to understand this has nothing to do with biology. The film's mixing it in, so maybe we can untangle it a little bit. But it has only to do with signifiers. So he's not saying anything about genders and body parts, but I think what this film is bringing in there is the reference to that part. And if the author of this book is a psychoanalyst, the Brazilian lady, can you remind me of her name?
Betty Milan was the real one.
Yeah. And, so and I wonder.
Yeah.
It seems to me like that must have some reference in the source material that was not fully dealt with in the film. But I think it's probably Lacan's Sexuation and Difference that's being referenced elliptically there.
Yeah, like I remember reading in the mirror stage that he compares, you know, a child looking in the mirror and recognizing themselves in the mirror. He compares that, which is a much sort of more cognitively developed version of like a pigeon, right? How a pigeon develops, right? Like the female gonads of a pigeon doesn't develop until it sees another one of its species, right? And there's a sort of parallel there between a child spotting itself in a mirror. Obviously, animals can't really recognize their images in mirrors. I mean, we think some dogs do, you know, when your poodle gets a haircut, it's depressed and sitting in front of the mirror. Okay, maybe it's that. But In the sort of psychoanalytic story of development, that moment of identification of the child who has this wobbly, unsupportable body with this sort of nice upright image in the mirror, and then that becomes the imago, and thus the sort of imaginary and the symbolic split is then sort of primordially established there. I'm probably getting that explanation wrong, but there is, again, sexuation is activated by sociality in a certain way, seeing the form or gestalt of your own image outside you and then identifying with it. Animals do this too, right? Like, you know, there's certain stories about, you know, certain phases of bird development don't start until the mother is cooing on while sitting on the eggs or something like that. Then that starts some kind of biological process. I mean, like, even all this is just to say, you know, the biological sexuation has always kind of played a part, and Lacan does seem to pay attention to, you know, what would you call it? Anatomy and neurology and sort of mainstream medical research as well.
This is, we're comparing early and late Lacan here. Like I said, Sexuation and Difference is one of the last things that he wrote. But when he says the woman does not exist, which I think he says straight up, it has nothing to do with the biological category of woman. It's about sexuation being real, not something that's imaginary.
He likes to say a lot of edgy things that sound crazy. He also says there is no sexual relationship, which is also...
The phallus and the lack are the two modes, right? There's the penis and penis envy in its more unfortunate characterization, right? Which is, you know, there again, if I'm reading about metaphors and metonymy, I'm like, okay, what is this metaphor of the phallus displacing? What's the metonym, the signifier? What's the whole then? And there's a certain kind of metaphorical clothing going on that's being interpreted literally. But I don't know. I'm not going to defend it because I don't know enough about it.
Yeah, if we want to be really edgy about it, we can't end an episode with it. We probably have to do a full episode on it to make sure that no one gets their foot in their mouth or their phallus in their mouth.
But one thing that she was complaining about this at one point, right? Like everything, you know, in Portuguese, you know, the sea is a masculine noun. In France, it's a feminine noun. The bank is masculine in Portuguese and in Brazilian Portuguese. And in French, the bank is a feminine noun. Like, and she's just complaining about these linguistic cultural differences that make her unable to be understood. And that then that connects up with, you know, the other kind of gender stuff going on in here as well. And I just thought, I mean, I didn't say we would untangle this thread, but it's definitely like there quite a bit. And her desire almost not to become a woman, and then the marital issues that result therefrom that psychoanalysis brings her to face is deeply linked to culture, language, gender, sex, those issues.
And one of her main things is to not be labeled, right? Not just with the gender. I don't want to give that away because it's like a key plot point, but not to be labeled as a Brazilian in France, or not to be labeled by her dialect of Portuguese as opposed to Portugal's dialect of Portuguese. She's very resistant to labels, which is resistance to the process of subjectification that, like you said, occurs beginning with the mirror stage.
Yeah.
In the beginning was the word, right? That's Lacan's borrowing from Genesis.
St. John.
But even in the sort of the story of Eve being derivative of Adam, of made of his ribs, right? We're all kind of primed towards this gendered, sexualized language thing. So I don't know how that's dealt with in the Lacanian literature, but in this film, it was an interesting tension that underlay her problems.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to talking to Richard.
I think that'll be the next step. I think this is as good of an little bit of a review / intro as we can give. So with that, why don't we end the first half of this, and we will bring on Richard to see what he says. And maybe he's already been brought on, depending on how this goes on the editing room floor. But anyway.
I think it was a good discussion of psychoanalysis, too. I think that in our previous discussions of Lacan, we really talked a lot more about the theory, and I think this was a good discussion of the actual method. So,
because we were avoiding the real issues, of course. Hopefully, our words were not opaque like things today.
Yeah, exactly.
We are not who we are. We already are who we are not wanting to be.
There you go.
Yeah, and just remember, desire is the desire of the other.
Don't
see you for phase two.
All right, we are now entering part two of two. And as you can probably hear by my voice, I'm actually using a real microphone this time. We watched the film, enjoyed it, reviewed it, sort of. We didn't get some stuff. And we have questions about other stuff, so who better to answer them than the writer and director of this film? 9.4 out of 10 on IMDb. So very spicy there. Very nice, dude. Welcome to our humble podcast, Mr. Richard Ledes. Thank you for being here.
My pleasure.
So, Richard, let me start off here with something broad, something easy. You're a filmmaker, perhaps more in the auteur romantique lineage. But the first thing that struck me about this film, in fact, the first thing that shocked me about this film, was that you made the very bold, some might say radical choice of releasing a film in 2022 without any CGI to speak of.
Right.
This is radical. So first question here, what's your take on the state of cinema in a reality that's more or less generated by an AI in Disney's basement?
You know, I think this film, Adieu Lacan, in many ways, in many levels, is conscious of limits. And it's not that I'm dead set against a CGI, but most of the time it leaves me not very excited by what I'm seeing, not very stimulated. You know, it's kind of like an endless pre-digested form of food. No, so this was very much, as you know, it takes place mainly in the consulting room of Lacan, and then a little bit in his waiting room, and in black and white. There are a few exterior scenes, shots that are in color. But working with, you know, within those extreme set of limits for this film was, you know, tremendously energizing for the crew, for the cast. And, you know, I think we were able to do things with these set of limitations that surprised me, you know, honestly. But I've been working, you know, I've been interested in Lacan's work going back over 20 years from when I did a piece of performance art based on the records of my mother's brother, who had a psychotic break and was a veteran of the Second World War. And I was fascinated by how these records that were intended to tell a story about him also told a story about the storytellers, about that time after the Second World War, which was this pivotal moment in the rise of mental health care, basically because soldiers, the young men, were a non-stigmatized patient population, as they say. You know, I came with a stack of books and I said, oh, you know, I'm reading all this stuff. And he said, well, you know, you really should meet people who do this work and you'll have a completely different feel about it. So I started to get to know all these different clinical groups. And the one that, you know, I formed a connection to that never left was a Lacanian Psychoanalytic Association in New York, made up mainly of analysts from Latin America or people who wanted to be analysts in training. And, you know, and it's always been fascinating to me, you know, the mix of interest in the visual arts, in literature, in philosophy, reading of Lacan and Freud. And so, I've stayed with it. I've stayed interested, and this opportunity came along, and you know, I think just all those years of experience really made. When you know we shot this in 10 days, so it's like being on a.
Oh my God!
yeah, it's like being on. I mean, and I was sick as a dog. Didn't know how I was, you know, going to show up one more time at 5 a.m. to do this. But you know, so many things, even on a film of this limited size, so many things have to go right. But you know, I'm very happy with what we were able to achieve.
So you pretty much answered my next question, which is why Lacan? Lacan's obscure except to grad students and of the psychoanalysts, maybe controversial. If you even know of him at all, but right. maybe I'll shift my question to what made you choose the source material, which is Lacan's Parrot.
It was a
right?
play called the main source was called Goodbye Doctor, a play by a Brazilian psychoanalyst who's become a friend, Betty Milan, and I was given an opportunity to. Direct a stage reading for a group of Lacanians. But I was so struck that the material was both to a audience of people who you know, spend their lives returning to the work of Lacan, palatable, or it had something to say. And at the same time, I thought, you know, this could this is pretty accessible. You know, this is really for someone who knows nothing about Lacan, but, you know, hell, it's the story of a woman who's, you know, wanted to have a child, has had two miscarriages, separated from her husband, whom she loves, and is feeling, you know, just alone. You know, a lot of people can relate to that on one level or another. So it was thinking, wow, this is both something that could appeal to a specialized audience that I have an affinity to over many, many years, and also a broader audience, really made me kind of start to begin to think about making the plunge. I made some changes that I'll mention right away. One is the play was called Goodbye Doctor, and there was Lacan was not mentioned. So, you know, calling it Adieu Lacan, I made it about Jacques Lacan. And the other thing was that in kind of maybe because Betty had done her analysis with Lacan, she had changed the story so that the person who is facing death is the mother of the analyst, not the analyst himself. And I knew, in fact, that, of course, it had been Lacan who was at that time getting, you know, this unwelcomed news. And so I changed that back and made that. Those were two, I think, significant changes that really drive the film forward.
Great. Yeah, I was wondering, kind of another sort of background question about yourself, because you were talking about kind of like doing performance art, but also pursuing an academic career, and then the filmmaking. And I'm kind of curious, like, how those things came together. Was one sort of had priority over the other, and did another one kind of come after, or were they always sort of interests that sort of coexisted?
I had been living in France for many years and doing like small jobs and, you know, writing on art for Art Form for a while. And, you know, graduate school seemed like a way to get back to the States. And, you know, the interest that I had had in the many years since I had been in school had continued in France. I had friends who had introduced me to Derrida, and I had started attending lectures by Derrida over the École Normale Supérieure. And then through a friend getting afflicted with AIDS and kind of starting to think about how this theory could be used to really address political issues, I became more interested in Foucault. And then, so in a way, though, you know, it's always been a kind of difficult match, I think, you know, it's between an interest in making film and an interest in subjects that are usually approached in a academic setting. And then, you know, my first film was about lobotomy, a woman that wants a lobotomy, starring Michelle Williams. And my research for my doctoral dissertation really became the basis for the screenplay. I had walked out on the street and to meet a friend, and I'd said, "Whoa, I'm reading about lobotomy. This stuff is fucked up." And he said, "Well, you know, my mother really wanted to get a lobotomy, and she finally succeeded." And I was like, "What?" And he said, no, yeah, you know, she really wanted a lobotomy. And she, and then I realized there had been a small but not, you know, a significant number of people who had read about lobotomy on the cover of the New York Times, you know, the inventor of the transorbital, you know, which really was at a good price point in those days. You know, the bilateral, you needed a neurosurgeon, to diagnose it. A neurologist to diagnose it, a neurosurgeon to perform it. You needed an anesthesiologist. And, you know, whereas the transorbital, you didn't even need a medical degree. The first ones were really done with an ice pick and using electroshock for anesthesia. So it brought down to the price point to a really nice place where they could really turn these things out. And so it, you know, they sold like hotcakes for a short time. So, and that way I segued back into filmmaking and yet have always, you know, kind of kept engaged with the Lacanians, you know, again, loving this kind of reading process that's involved. You know, I studied ancient Greek as a kid, and my first real attention to Lacan was someone had asked me to write a version of the Antigone. And that day I happened to read an obituary for Laurence Bataille, the, I guess, daughter-in-law of Jacques Lacan. And it mentioned in this obituary that Lacan had brought to her when she was in prison for protesting against the French, involvement in Algeria. He had brought to her his portion, I think, of his seventh seminar on the Antigone. So I took this as a sign, you know, right? Mm. I'm Antigone. So I went and it wasn't published. And I read the typescript. My French was non-existent, but I knew the Greek. So I kind of, you know, worked through this. And so that was where, how I first started to read Lacan. And, you know, again, I've always loved these really torturously hard reading processes like Greek. And so, you know, and a few of them, you know, a few Lacanians are also, really into jazz or also playwrights or also direct opera. You know, so there's a kind of eclectic group.
I noticed that Sophocles made a very brief cameo in your film as well.
Yes, yes, yeah.
There were a few little cameos, yeah, for the theory literate crowd.
Oh yeah. I mean, you know, like Corey Diskin, the production designer, who did a great job, but I was very particular. You know, sometimes on a set, they're kind of like, "Hey, we need some books here. Put some books there." I'm like, "No. We're not just putting books there. You know, we are going to be very careful about which books are there." And you know, so yeah, all those choices were. I mean, they're not. They're not like a secret. reading, but they were very, you know, what Lacan was working on at that time, some of the influences, some of my own passions in relation to Lacan. But yeah, all of that was carefully chosen.
Yeah, there are some definite Easter eggs in there, both for the theory literate crowd and those knowledgeable about France. Some of the statues and the opening shots.
Can we ask about one in particular? Because we were wondering about it. Why the death of Mao newspaper?
Oh yeah.
Well, you know, it came up as a possibility. I went, oh yeah. Oh yeah. That's good. Yeah, let's use that. You know, it introduces again death. You know, for one thing, there's the theme of Lacan's death. You know, the sense of, I mean, I think it's what, you know, one of the things a lot of people say is, oh, he's so much more sympathetic than he comes across in the Rudinesco biography. And, you know, there are a number of reasons for that. I think, you know, my own connection is through particularly my late friend Alain Didier Weil, who was analyzed by Lacan and as the editor of Cartier-Lacan, which is an interview with all these people who were analyzed by Lacan, and I think had a warmer sense of who Lacan was. You know, I think also you have the voiceovers where, you know, I think at one point he says shit, which is, you know, that he's course corrected. He really is not. You know, he really doesn't know necessarily, you know, with all that presence. You know, he's not only, maybe supposed to know, but, you know, he's kind of thinking on his feet. He's very performative. I think one of the things I found really interesting about it was thinking about Lacan as analysis as a performative act in a way. You know, references he makes in passing to circus or vaudeville, you know, the fact that his Sylvie Bataille, of course, was a great beauty, great actress. Mm-hmm. And the presence of death, you know, his own mortality. So I think that was one reason. And, Mao, I think Mao is also a figure, a political figure, a figure of the communist tradition, which really reflects that time period. Certainly a lot of people around Lacan were very interested in Mao. So it had a lot of echoes to it.
Yeah, I loved that sort of parallel struggle in a way. Some of the things that Lacan seemed to be going through in the film paralleled some of the things that Sarajevo was going through.
Right.
And it really sort of, it humanizes him in a way, which is very nice because he's such a towering figure in theory and he seems like he's got all the answers, but it sort of humanizes him and brings him down to earth. And I really enjoyed that. And then the Mao reference, really, for me, it like you were saying, it hooked in these contextual aspects. Like, I mean, the French Communist Party was huge,
right.
And there are all kinds of divisions. You know, are you a post-Marxist or a Maoist or a Stalinist, and all those sorts of divides that really emerged. So it nicely like hooked that stuff in for me. And that's sort of what I thought. He was reading the other side. He's like, even the heart has a gender. And then you see Mao on the other side of the paper. It was really, it's just one of those things that your imagination can then sort of fill in all these things in the film. And it's really great. But one thing I also wanted to ask about too is just as background, the idea of filming it all in this single room, in this single space. And I did a little looking around and saw you mentioned you have some inspiration behind dealing with films as something shot sequentially in a single space, you know, over 10 days, as you said. Was it Robert Altman is an inspiration for you for that?
Yes. Well, for shooting in sequence, you know, there are very few filmmakers who regularly have shot in a sequence. Antonioni is one, Robert Altman is another. I have done two films with Elliot Gould, who did a lot of really great work with Altman. And working with Elliot, I kind of picked up the ghost of, or was inspired by the ghost of Altman in some ways, and began in another really low-budget film done, shot very quickly, called Fred Won't Move Out, began to, which was my first experiment shooting in sequence. And you can really do things in terms of, you know, like playing a piece of music. You can really feel the room and feel how things are going, and therefore take chances with the camera. And I was, you know, also time was so important because of course, the short sessions, which Sarayama is revolting against, or not short sessions, variable length sessions, where you know, Lacan, like the director, is calling cut in a sense, were made me very aware of the sense of time. And then, of course, also that film and psychoanalysis have, in a way, the same birthday of 1895, or at least grow up at the end of the 19th century, that they're both inventions. You know, I mean, psychoanalysis is in many ways an invention, and so is cinema. And I think one of the things that Lacan did was, in returning to Freud, he was also, you know, translating the inventive spirit of Freud, you know, by Levi-Strauss and Saussure and Kojève, in so many ways, for all that he emphasized the sense of return, one of the things he was returning to was a sense of invention, of a certain kind of being out on the edge of things in a way that was not acceptable to what the dominant American form of psychoanalysis at that time, when they dominated the IPA, they dominated, as they did many fields at that time. And, you know, he was pushing back against that. Whereas, you know, psychoanalysis in the United States was highly medicalized at that time, run by the American Medical Association. There was a real effort to have it become a medical profession. And it was kind of like, it popped. It was incredibly successful for a short time. So after the Second World War, but it's this really odd form to this day, called ego psychology. You know, I mean, it was everywhere. It was incredibly present in popular culture, and then it just bombed. It had very reactionary ideas about what women should be doing in the society, about homosexuality. So in being medicalized, the nightmare that Freud had worried about in lay analysis and writing about lay analysis, that, you know, that physicians, for them, not in all cases, but often their training is not Shakespeare, it's not Dante, it's not Goethe, you know, it's not these things that were intrinsic to Freud's formation, and that, you know, Lacan, who's of course drawing on whether it's the Antigone or the Marquis de Sade, is very much in touch with the American translation. Strachey's translation kind of emphasized a more medical approach, and was really trying to institutionalize, whereas, you know, Lacan was pushing, you know, pushing the envelope in a certain way as he was addressing what was really, you know, things that were important in society and which remain very important today.
As part of your PhD, if I'm not mistaken, or your graduate work at least, was you were a volunteer or worked at an outpatient facility for the severely mentally ill. Yeah. And I was wondering if you could discuss some of those experiences, maybe how they influenced you, your views on mental health, on psychology, and maybe how it influenced your filmmaking.
Yeah, it really is a period in my life that was a real catalyst. I mean, you know, I often joke, well, my first film was about lobotomy. This one's about psychoanalysis. Come on, let's say, you know. But so clearly, you know, these are interests that have stayed with me. But I was volunteering at an outpatient center for severely chronically mentally ill. And you know, basically, if you're in a hospital, the state has to pay for you. If you're homeless, the federal government picks up much more. So this was part of the push for transorbital, and then basically for pharmaceuticals originally, starting with Thorazine, was to be able to transfer, starting with California under Reagan, to transfer the financial burden of mental health care from the states to the federal government. This was after, you know, at the end of the Second World War, they built these huge hospitals. They thought they were going to just be able to put people in for short periods of time and then bring them out, and that model hadn't worked. So an outpatient center for severely chronically mentally ill is a rarity, and you know, it's really fortunate. The people who were there were, you know, they from a long shot, they weren't in any sense lucky, but given the possibilities of the mental health care in the U.S., which is kind of a, you know, there's a narrative that gets repeated every 60 or 70 years, which is of a horror show. I mean, at the end of the Second World War, during the Second World War, there had been all these conscientious objectors who were often sent to work in the psychiatric hospitals. And these were really smart, you know, people connected. They were Mennonites, for example. And so they saw this horror show, and they carefully documented it. You know, they took notes. And so at the end of the Second World War, there's an expose in the New York Times, in Life magazine, with these brutal photos of the conditions in psychiatric hospitals. And so action is taken. It's also at a moment where the profession of psychiatry in the U.S. wanted to move out of the hospitals. They wanted to be like their colleagues who were, you know, the new suburbs, and they wanted to be treating this new middle class. And so it also served them. And the model they took was from, you know, wartime, in a sense, that soldiers had gotten better by being treated. This was what they said. And this gets reset after the Vietnam War, after the war in Iraq. It always gets rediscovered. It's an amazing act of forgetting and remembering that goes on. You know, that war, holy shit, we just discovered war. It's incredibly bad for you. You know? And then they, you know, send out young people to one more time be brutalized in the war. And then they go, holy shit, this is really bad. So there was a brief moment after the Second World War where there was a real interest in mental health care, a real earnest interest. And it's the time when the National Institute of Mental Health is formed. The first Mental Health Act is right after the Second World War. So there's this real engineered or moment of real consensus around it. But so this place where I was volunteering, I was running groups where we were reading aloud the short stories of Edgar Allan Poe, Hawthorne, and Melville, which the people in these groups loved it because, you know, usually in these groups, they would have to kind of reproduce their illness or, you know, there was a kind of closed circuit. So there was a way in which, like, the voice was an instrument and they got to play these amazing tunes. So those were great. And then there was a theater program, which at that time was where they would come up with their own plays. And the play, which I was involved with, they came up with, which was called Room 13A. And it was about a medicine, a pill, which could cure all mental illness, but had one side effect. It brought back the dead.
Hey, psychoanalysis.
And I thought, oh my God, this is psychoanalysis. You know, whatever. It was so fascinating. And and that program, around the time I was there, was being shut down. And the theater, just to show you how these things, the theater program, which was so amazing, they changed it. So they said it's much more useful if the clients, they were called clients, if the clients had work where the theatrical situations were like they're behind a cash register at McDonald's, or they're checking someone's bags.
Gross.
You know, something much more, you know, whereas what we were doing was much different than that. It really wasn't at all about adaptation to whatever you want to call it, neoliberal economy or, you know, this kind of, but so that, you know, maybe in some ways for better, but in some ways for worse, is symptomatic of the way in which programs like that, which were being, I mean, the program was called continuous. that's the only word I remember, continuous. And as somebody said, that was the kiss of death. You know, to anyone like, you know, that continuous, oh, get rid of that program, you know.
Oh, man. Yeah. Drugs and lobotomies. Yeah. I mean, I remember learning that the inventor of the transorbital lobotomy won a Nobel Peace Prize, I think, in like the 50s. But of course, it was shocking because I had watched One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest by then and sort of seen, I don't know if it was a transorbital, but the like sort of closing scenes is just him as a vegetable kind of thing. And it's shocking from today's perspective, I guess, that was considered a treatment.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was interesting was that it was really about the criteria. You know, they would say this woman complains about doing laundry. She no longer complains about doing laundry. Or, you know, often people in institutional settings, you know, who were a pain in the ass, and then the next day they weren't a pain in the ass. And so, and that was, you know, that was the criteria for improvement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then there's this sort of weird middle ground between, you know, normalizing somebody, making them fit into the already sort of dominant beliefs that you have to be a part of society. And then there's the sort of lobotomy, or even just sort of the bedlam model, I guess, is just take them out, put them aside, out of sight, out of mind. And then, you know, it's like psychoanalysis tries to adopt a middle ground almost. And I just love the idea, you know, this analysis is where you can start to forge a new path forward rather than being removed from society, rather than being normalized.
Quotes. Right. And it also, you know, it doesn't necessarily, the idea of cure, it's not really there. It's kind of, you know, more of, seeing symptoms outside of the model of trying to get back to normal. You know, it's more about, I love the moment when David Patrick Kelly, the actor who plays Lacan, very near the beginning, goes, "You're in analysis." You know, it's like, you know, anything is possible. Mm. It's a wonderful moment where he seems like, you know, a little crazy. But, you know, it's kind of, it's you know, refreshing in a way that it's, you know, it's about these possibilities that come from this process. So,
I'm glad you brought it back to the film, because we're about halfway done and I want to make sure we get to pick your brain about that specifically.
Yeah.
So I had one question. In that this film depicts analysis, the process of analysis, you know, more or less realistically. Of course, there's cuts and all that, but more or less realistically, except for one choice you made that breaks the depiction or disrupts the depiction, which is to give the viewer access to Lacan's thoughts via voiceover. Oh,
I thought you were going to say the capoeira dance.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That, but of course, that usually takes place, usually not that early in the analytical process. But there is, usually the capoeira is, no, I'm sorry.
I actually forgot about that scene. But anyway, I wanted to ask about the voiceover because Lacan occupies this position of the other for Sariema. But then the viewer gets not only access to Sariema's process, her working out, but also to Lacan's thought and in some cases his strategy, like what he's trying to get out of her. So I was wondering what your thinking was behind the use by giving the audience that kind of transcendent point of view in that situation.
Well, here again, I can give credit to and blame Betty Milan, who in the stage version, Goodbye Doctor, had these soliloquies where the characters were turned. And, this is one of the places where film is so great with voiceover, which creates a voice which has, is kind of just floating. It's not situated in any way. And so I used the voiceover for these internal voices that Betty had created and that I think work well. There's one, another thing about the structure of the film and what attracted me to it was the idea that Sariema is the question of childbirth. I was thinking of Socrates and this metaphor for analysis that Lacan was very fond of maieutics, that like Socrates says, I have no idea. All I can do is be a midwife and give birth to what's inside you. This truth. And so in a way, Sariema has to give birth to her own subjectivity before she can give birth to a child, that her symptom, which is, as we find out, involves childbirth and fantasies around pregnancy. So there was this double level, in a way. There was both that is a narrative, and there was also that in terms of the analytical process from Lacan's perspective that also, interested me, because often these kinds of doubling things are very resonant and give you a chance to do something that otherwise might just slip away.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was just digging a little more into the film. When you said that about Lacan's influences, he was influenced by Saussure and Levi-Strauss, and obviously that's one of Lacan's twists he puts on psychoanalysis, is to bring semiotics into play, and we know the importance of words and what is usually called the signifier in Lacan. And some of these words that are popping up, because of the language conflict between the Brazilian Portuguese and the French of Lacan, it really highlights in a way the importance of language in the psychoanalytic process.
Yes.
And I wanted to know your thoughts on that, and even how you chose these words, even if that's not giving away too much. Like the first one I believe that pops up is Maktub, meaning fate, destiny, or literally it is written. Some of these words, and eventually obviously the name of the father kind of becomes another point of another lightning rod for insight. And how did you work these signifiers into the story?
What I can take credit for is doing the film in English, which was to add a third language. She's speaking in Brazilian Portuguese, or no, that's her first language. The analysis is taking place in French, which for her is a second language. And then this is all represented in English, which is yet a third language. And of course, it's the one for various reasons was the easiest for me. It's the one where, I mean, I have done a few things in French. So again, that kind of highlighted language in yet another way, that you're kind of, in a way, between languages rather than in any one language. And which has a very interesting effect. I mean, we all live, we may not be aware of it necessarily, but you know, where we all live, I mean, English is not, even the title. I mean, one of the things that drew me to the title, Adieu Lacan, is, you know, I picked up a dictionary, and I think Merriam-Webster, and there was adieu. I mean, adieu is a word is considered an English word. So this kind of betweenness of languages, even within, you know, what we sometimes can reflexively think of as monolithic, you know, English or French, or in fact, and some languages are more like this, are even more kind are made up of different rocks, different crystals or different things within them, was, I think, something that has a very subtle effect. I can't take credit, unfortunately, for the choice. Betty is from Lebanon originally. It's her own story of her own analysis with Lacan, the play. What I took from the novel was really just the introduction, that first speech where she says, which I love, where she goes, look, one thing I'm not going to talk about because it's not relevant is immigration and being being an immigrant. I mean, it has nothing to do. And of course, it's everything. But it's that was the one monologue or one speech at the beginning, which comes from the novel. The rest really came from the play, and I brought it into, because it was such a key element, and the kind of rejection of it was so striking.
Good. I was wondering as well about, or going back to something that Pills was just saying about the choice of the voiceover, and just generally, I think the film, you know, and its ability to depict Lacanian psychoanalysis, you know, as you mentioned, the variable length sessions, and all those different things. I'm wondering, were there certain aspects in the play or in the novel that, like, you either didn't end up including, or, and just broadly, I guess, the challenge of trying to capture some of these Lacanian idiosyncrasies to, like, the analytic process? Because I know what Pills was asking was about the voiceover, and when he was asking that question, I was sort of thinking, well, the voiceover makes it possible to see, like, the kind of work that Lacan as an analyst is actually doing, because a lot of it is just him saying, go on, speak, you know, and it's like, to someone who doesn't know much, it would seem like he's not doing much. But of course, the goal is to try to get to subjectivize the unconscious, exactly, right? To get the conversation to happen between the analyst and their own unconscious, and try to not subjectify Lacan, right? It's trying to get him out of that position. That requires a work that you probably can't see unless you're in Lacan's mind, in a way. So that challenge, that was depicted well, I thought.
Right. Yeah, so we're seeing, on one hand, the depiction of a subjectification, by one method, the psychoanalytic method. And then that is also, I don't think it's negligible, represented on a screen using, Richard, your method,
right,
which is the film depiction. So you are subjectifying him as he is trying to subjectify her unconscious.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. It was, you know, I think the camera, which we, you know, again, we drew up, I had looked at this TV series in treatment, and I thought, wow, boy, do I not want to do that. you know, because the camera was always level to the ground, and it made sense for that, because it was about two people. One person is a professional who knows certain things. The other person has issues, and they can, the professional can transmit to the other that professional knowledge. And that ain't what I was after. You know, what I, the model I found was in Carl Dreyer's Joan of Arc, which, you know, uses these extreme angles. It's about this woman who's being, you know, she's going to be burned at the stake. And there's this whole sense of, you know, of powerlessness, of power, of knowledge, you know, of who has knowledge. And it's actually very dynamic, because as I looked back at Dreyer's film and I thought about how Joan d'Arc in some ways is helpless, but, you know, in the camera, but also she has all, she's with God, you know, I mean, so she's also, you know, screw them, you know, so she's, and the camera, so it's not a simple matter of, oh, you choose a high angle to make her look helpless and then a low angle. It's much more of a dynamic and dramatic process. So, you know, we also went back and used, and Valentina Caniglia, the cinematographer, whom I've worked with a few times and did such a great job on this film. We shot 4:3, you know, this aspect ratio that goes back to the earliest cinema, and which is so great for the individual subject, for one, you know, for that portrait, and black and white, you know, which again, for this subject matter worked so well. And I think those kinds of angles, and being very economical about choices we made. There's one overhead shot.
Richard. I have to fanboy here a second, because that is there's two great shots in the film, and that is one of them, my favorite one, because, well, so, for the listeners here, this is an auditory medium and I'm trying to describe a visual depiction, but you'll see where I'm going. The screen is looking down on the office from above, and on the bottom half of the split, there is the two chairs that are facing each other where they look at each other and speak, and at the top half of the split is the couch where she lays down and ultimately he sits behind her. And this split screen is separated by a white bar that they both cross. They cross from the chairs facing each other over to the couch. And, you know, the real Lacan heads out there, you'll know what I'm saying. The split, the bar, halfway through analysis. Yeah. So this is a conquering of the physical space that is crossing the split in the subject.
She's conquered the couch.
They conquer her subjectivity in this split screen scene. Mm-hmm. Great job. Great work.
Yes, and there's the mention of sex just before that, the sex of words, you know, that with French and Portuguese having words, you know, each word having its sex and the question of sex. And then, you know, I was thinking of the barred subject and that line there that it creates this cut.
So they're penetrating the couch, not just conquering it.
Bill, we'll let you go. We'll let you go on with that.
No, I really loved the angles as well.
You know, because, I claim what we see in this scene is Lacan fucking the screen.
there's right. Our obligatory Zizek reference. the way you use that, because it's such a small space, but it always felt like there was just more coming out of it by the angles, but also the focus on the objects in the room. There's effigies, there's the books, there's the sort of little, I don't know if you call them partial objects or things she fixates on every now and then.
And the Bormian knot, let's not forget.
Yeah, I noticed that. Yeah, he holds up this like sort of, it just looks like he's untangling wires or something almost, but for a second, it's like, oh my God, that's the Bormian knot. That's the real imaginary symbolic interlinkage there.
And David Patrick Kelly and I, it turned out by chance, we both had studied mime in Paris. And we really bonded around that. But And that object, I mean, he just, well, he loved playing, he fell in love with Lacan, playing Lacan. There was something about David Patrick Kelly, who's a really interesting, you know, human being, actor, really classically trained, and for whom the work of the actor is a profound thought process and role in society. He found playing Lacan absolutely mesmerizing. And the more me and not was something he became preoccupied with. And he chose the moment of, you know, it's the one moment where, you know, we have Lacan's voiceover, but the one moment where he speaks to himself out loud is just in connection to the Boromir knot, you know, that, and he asks a question about why she's made one choice around money and not another. And I thought it was just, you know, it was just spot on and worked in a way that I'm very happy.
Yeah. And I don't know if this is just a connection I'm making in my head, but also the way you use the space. And you brought up Dreyer, and I remember in an interview I saw you also mentioned Paul Schrader and the transcendental yes. style, and he speaks about Dreyer to exemplify it yes. quite a bit. But also he's kind of in the end says maybe Bresson does it a bit better, but the point is representing the wholly other.
Oh, there's a key term. Eric, could you quickly let us know what the transcendental style is?
Yeah, I mean, it's the transcendental style is a method of I guess creating tensions within the space of the film. And eventually what you want to do is evoke a sense of the holy other, which I read when I read Schrader, I read that as a religious thing. But then when I saw the film and about Lacan, I'm like, oh, my, the holy other, right?
Right, yes.
The unconscious and the angles, I thought, and the ways you use the space really just sort of created those tensions. I know it wasn't like a gothic space. It was more of a human-sized space. But it still evoked that transcendental kind of style for me. And maybe that's just because you mentioned it. And then I went back and watched the film again. And my mind has started putting those connections in there.
Valentina and I had that very much in mind. And also, you know, Schrader talks about how most films try to grab you by the throat and never let go. You know, they're just this. And then he said this is transcendental style. And I remember he mentions this film by Victoria De Sica, where there's this poor girl trying to light a match and she can't light it. And then she tries again and she can't light it. And she tries again and she can't light it. Just, you know, Hollywood, that cut, that's gone. But, you know, that in this transcendental style, you hold on things and suddenly they have a meaning. You know, he says, well, it's either really boring and you're really bored, or you start to lean in instead of this thing that's constantly trying to overwhelm you with stimulation. You know, you start to, you realize you have to lean in. You have to be involved with performance of what's going on. And of course, for people interested in analysis and also I would say critical theory, they have, by their very nature, an affinity with that kind of process, you know, that that the production in a way, a certain part of the production is taking place during the making of the film, but then a certain amount of the production is taking place in the reception of the film. And so leaving room for that, you know, we were very conscious of like, you know, we were going to risk being boring. You know, we were going to like not push this in terms of pacing and such, to really kind of you know, really be working in a particular way. And that's why also filming in sequence, you can really much more work on that edge, I think.
Yeah, and I really loved the, I guess in my head I read it almost as transposing those Gothic tensions that you get from Gothic architecture. You know, it's like, it's really big. There's a lot of downward pressure. You need all kinds of apparatus to sort of diffuse that downward force or the whole thing will collapse. And that seemed to me sort of transposed onto the, I guess, the chain of signifiers, the sort of thinking that goes on in Sarayama's head and then her engagements with Lacan. Like when she sort of first said, like, I'm from Lebanon, but I don't want him to know that. I want him to think I'm sort of a daughter of the founder of Brazil. But then, and then it's like, oh, but is he going to think I'm Indian? I don't want him to think that. Then his first question, of course, is, or one of them anyways, is, do you have Indian blood in you? And then she goes, oh, what the heck? Like those sorts of little, like, I want this, but I don't want that. And then something else happens. I don't want this, but I want that. And it, this, the tensions seem to be transposed onto the, you know, the chain of signifiers. The narrative or the talking itself seem to capture those sorts of tensions that Schrader describes in Dreyer's style as well. And I really love that bit.
And speaking of that top-down tension, I think she says at one point explicitly, I don't want the labels. I don't want to be labeled as nothing.
Right.
Which speaks exactly to that downward tension that that you're kind of referencing.
She's, you know, she's the protagonist, you know. I mean, she's the she's the Anna Lee Sand, right? I mean, she's the one, and that's what's, I think, also great about the film or the story, you know, is that in the end she, in the final scene where she walks out and Lacan is in a much more, it's almost like he's depleted, you know, he's spent in a certain way. He reaches out to get the money and she just leaves it on the table and walks out. But, you know, she's kind of, she pushes back. I mean, that was something very early on, that before we started shooting, the Ismenia Mendez, the actor, actress who plays the woman who does the analysis, was asking me and spoke to Betty, you know, can I, you know, can I push back against him? And, you know, that's a, that's one thing where I think, you know, you're translating somewhat into contemporary terms. I think Betty was surprised at how much Ismenia chose to, like, give him hell or push back a little bit. But I think it's, you know, again, it translates well in terms of contemporary zeitgeist around gender and politics, but it's but it does work very well. And yeah, she really, you know, she is, it's her voice, right? It's Adieu Lacan is her. She's the one who says Adieu Lacan.
This is maybe a much broader question, and it's okay if you don't feel equipped to answer it, but like sort of just the discourse of mental health in North America and the English, it seems like it's been growing more acceptance, like destigmatizing it, but at the same time it seems like psychoanalysis is kind of delegitimized in at least the Anglo-American world. And I find that those two things kind of happen in parallel, and there's sort of a proliferation of, you know, ultra, I guess what they call evidence-based approaches. And I wonder if you had thoughts about like what, like how that, and also the interesting thing that in the Latin American world, right, and in France, I'm assuming, like, these things are still, like, at least Lacanian analysis are still pretty popular. So I don't know if you had thoughts about that dynamic. It's kind of a broad question.
Well, it's the reception of Adieu Lacan has been really great in Mexico, in Brazil, Argentina. You know, Lacanian groups that I would probably never have come into contact with were organized screenings online. And then we have a discussion, and they're great. I mean, they're really so interesting to find in areas of Latin America, Central America, people who are interested in Lacan want to see the film and to discuss it. So that was incredibly exciting and very interesting in terms of, you know, those countries' own approaches to symptoms and mental health care, and very different than that in the United States. It's certainly the pandemic has brought about a proliferation of discourses, discussions around mental illness, symptoms. At the same time, a lot of it seems to be confined within a paradigm which is the dominant paradigm. And it's interesting that up to the Second World War, you know, quantum physics in terms of the paradigmatic science, it was really physics. And then after the war, it becomes biology. In a way, for Lacanian psychoanalysis, I think the paradigmatic science in some ways is quantum physics.
Zizek mentions that quite a bit. I think he brings up the quantum physics example.
Yeah. I had done research, the history of psychiatry section of the Payne-Whitney, which is the oldest history of psychiatry section in the U.S., used to be in the basement of the Payne-Whitney, which if you were insane and anyone important, you went mad there. And William Burroughs, Marilyn Monroe, if you became at Payne-Whitney, if you stayed there, you had a silver napkin ring with your name engraved. Elizabeth Bishop was there. They had suicide-proof windows. It was built in the 20s, and it was finally torn down in the 90s. I filmed it with a little video camera after it had been torn down, and the people who had been staying in these rooms started to write on the walls with magic markers, and I still have that footage. But it was incorporated afterwards. It was incorporated into the hospital. In other words, today, if you go over to the east side and you look for the Payne-Whitney, it's a branch within the hospital. And, you know, if you look at the history of mental health care in the U.S., just in New York City, there's this wandering relationship between how close or distant the mental health care is from the physical treatment of physical illnesses.
Interesting. And,
you know, there are times when they've gotten closer or farther away. Now they're really joined at the hip. I think there are, you know, I'm not a clinician and I don't pretend to be one, I can't provide that. But certainly, there are real problems and challenges to that paradigm. I think there's a lot of possibilities offered by the alternative paradigm that I think psychoanalysis, and particularly Lacanian psychoanalysis, offers both either directly or through its influence on more traditional treatment modalities.
Yeah. I remember one time I was sitting in the backyard of my friend and his dad, who we have a very good conversational relationship. He started talking to me after a few beers about sort of like anxiety, and it was so striking to me, like his anxiety. And it was so striking how he was talking about it in purely scientific terms about like brain chemistry. And he's like, they discovered that there was like this chemical imbalance. And it's like, he totally wanted to, you know, create this objective barrier between him and I was so curious. I prodded a little bit, but he was very resistant to want to talk about it in any other terms.
Right.
which is
the tagline for the film is or the log line tag is the passion for ignorance is the worst passion of all, or
That's great.
Often really don't want to know.
Yeah,
I love that. And I think one of the lines in the film that works against that sort of also interpretation that Victor was just discussing is that if we're, if we forget the past, then we're going to become a victim of it, mm-hmm. to sort of repeat it over and over again. And the effort to bring back the memories that have been repressed is part of the point of the process, not simply, treating it with drugs, which have their place maybe here and there.
Right.
But in the end, it's about not just the words you're using, which are the important clue, but also leading the and Alison to bring back the memories that matter, because then, to another quote, life depends on what we can say. And I guess you'd say, being out of sorts depends on what we can't let ourselves say.
Right.
You mentioned earlier, Richard, about In Treatment, which I remember kind of enjoying that show. It came out a while ago.
I did too.
I wasn't interpreting you as necessarily knocking it. Just I know you were talking about the cinematography style, right? But that made me just thinking about that, like, of the depictions in film of therapy. I was just kind of curious if you had like any favorite depictions aside from your own depiction of therapy in film. There's The Sopranos, obviously, that has that famous line, and then obviously like Cronenberg did that film on Freud, which only showed analysis like very briefly. So
they tend to, films on analysis tend not to show analysis.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
It's very interesting. Even like Shock Corridor, where they we have to go to treatment. Give her a couple injections. the issue of time, John Huston, who did this film that I was very interested in it was the last of three films he did for the war effort during World War II. It was called Let There Be Light, and it was about returning soldiers who have what we now would call post-traumatic stress disorder, and they go to this hospital in a hospital setting, and they're treated with a kind of McDonald's form of psychoanalysis using these drugs that supposedly speed it up. But he thought he had made this film, which was highly patriotic, but it was the night it was supposed to be released or premiered at MoMA. Military police grabbed it, and it wasn't released for another 30 years.
Wow.
At which point, when it was finally released, people thought, what's the big deal? It's nothing so, about this film. But I think in a way, again, it was at a time when they finally decided, boy, this makes war look bad. because these guys are really messed up. It really has not been kind to them. And I think it was just, there was a shift. There was a little slight window after the Second World War when there was an openness about what had happened. And then it just closed shut really quick. And I think the film bridged it, but that gave him the motivation to do, a film with Montgomery Clift, which had various different titles, included a Secret Passion, where Montgomery Clift plays Sigmund Freud on a script that was originally written by Jean-Paul Sartre, and then went through all kinds of rewrites and everything. And it's still, but again, it's about the discovery of psychoanalysis. And the minute they discover psychoanalysis, the film's over. I mean, they really, and it's not by chance, I can't remember how many times I've walked into major museums with shows on the surrealist, and they talk about the surrealists were very interested in the subconscious. No, they weren't interested in the subconscious, and it's really striking when these major institutions start talking about somehow efface on the unconscious. So it's curious. There are a few examples like that. But I'm probably, repressing my own. I can only think of my own.
fair enough. So,
I would love to know, as we wrap up, Richard Ledes, what's next for you? What is the next project you'll be working on?
V13 is based on a play called Vienna 1913, which is about two young men who become friends. One is living in the park. He's homeless, loves animals, artist, vegetarian, Adolf. And then the other young man is sent to Freud to do an analysis. Mm-hmm. And his symptom, of which he's very embarrassed because he knows better, is that he feels an instinctive revulsion tinged with hatred for Jews. And it's about the rise of anti-Semitism in Vienna before the First World War. It was written by Alain Didier Weil, my late friend. And I've been working on it for years and years and years. And it predates by, a decade, Adieu Lacan. And in a way, it's part of what drew me to Adieu Lacan. And now finally I'm making it. We're shooting it in New York. We're kind of like a modern dress Shakespeare. We're shooting New York today for Vienna before the First World War, with some interesting echoes around some of the rise of fascism, et cetera. So I'm just beginning to cast that. I wish I could share with you some of the, but I can't. We're working on that, and we'll begin filming that in October.
Nice. All right. Awesome. That sounds exciting.
Yeah. That's excellent. One final question, very quickly. If people have been listening to this, I mentioned at the very beginning of the episode that this is available. You can rent it through Amazon app and the Apple app. I was wondering if that's right, or how are you sending people to be able to watch this?
Right. If they're overseas, they should go to my website, richardledes.com. That's richardledes.com. And for that film and for the other films as well, we have links. The reason that's important is because Amazon and Apple are only for English-speaking countries. And a lot of the interest in the film is from overseas. And so the film is available through a platform called Eventive if you're in, for example, Mexico or France or Argentina. So for those listeners, that's where they can find a link that they can, by which they can view the film.
So if you, no matter where you are, if you go to your website, you can find something that fits or that works for you.
That's right.
Okay. I will put that in the show notes, richardledes.com. Thank you so much for coming and hanging out with us. We had a great time. This was a little bit outside of our normal capacity, but I think all of us enjoyed it, looking at Eric's smiling face through the Zoom.
This was a great treat.
Yeah, it was.
For me as well. I'm very, I'm very grateful to have this discussion.
Great. All right, excellent. As are we. Thank you, listeners. If you have made it all the way to the end, this has been, what are we on, 91? 91 or so. And thank you, Richard. Yeah. And we'll see you next week.
All right.